on the menu today. Now all we can do is track the ISS and wait for it to come overhead. So that's your line, okay? Got it?
Welcome.
I'm sure the first dog in space is still completely fine. Oh, hello, Chip Dippers. Welcome back to Retro Recipes. It's so nice to see you here again. And here on our little channel, we're going to keep reaching for the stars. She reaches for her. Well, never mind. Because we're going to be trying to contact the International Space Station from the Commodore 64. Yes, now that crazy-haired looking lady is on the ISS right now, or at least in that video. But here's what really spurred this project along. I was chatting with one of my patrons, Simon Klukas, who works for ESA, yeah, the European Space Agency. And we've been discussing an idea of whether it might be possible to send a Commodore 64 in some form into space. Now, Elon Musk, if you happen to be watching this, from one Tesla owner to another, well, the owner of Tesla, we could really use your help with this project, so please do reach out. Better than my cable reaches. Now, there's going to be much more on that coming up in this new year, so do make sure you are subscribed if you don't want to miss out on the evolution of that project. But it inspired another patron, Lee Valanti, to get in touch because he is still an amateur radio enthusiast. And long story short, instead of putting a Commodore 64 in space and talking to it from Earth, the idea was born to use a Commodore 64 on Earth to talk to space. But the ISS, we've been able to see it with our naked eyes for the last 22 years. It orbits the Earth 15 times a day at a speed of 22,000 kilometers per hour, at a height of just over 400 kilometers away. Let's take a step outside and go and see if we can see it. And of course, the ISS is controlled, or not controlled, but mission control is over in Houston, Texas.
Houston. Huh? Houston, Texas.
That's Houston, but I'll prove it.
Whitney Houston seemed to have it all.
See? BBC.
Houston, we have a problem.
I mean, you don't say Hugh Grant, do you? It's Hugh Grant. Anyway, we're going to look at the International Space Station from here.
Are you okay?
Yeah, so it's actually going to be behind us. So take a couple of steps back and backwards.
No.
Damn it. Okay, let's see if we can see it. That was quick. See?
Is that actually it?
Yeah, see it?
Yep.
We timed that really well. Do you see it? Wait, where's it gone?
Right there.
It actually moves surprisingly fast, and it goes around the Earth 15 times per day.
Quite busy, aren't they?
They're busy and busy.
So what exactly are we looking at?
That's a very good question.
Well, before the pandemic, I was lucky enough to visit the Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas, to take a look at, well, the full-size replica of the ISS itself. This is a kind of disjointed version of the ISS sitting in the world's largest swimming pool. Now, I have seen a lot of cool things in my time, met a lot of cool dogs, but I tell you, when I saw that, I said to myself, this is the coolest thing you have ever seen. You can probably see some of the childhood wonderment in my eyes, seeing our space station right there in front of me. Just incredible. I also was lucky enough to go inside a replica, not in the pool, of the ISS, where I did a little floating around, just like her, and also visited the ISS control room. I even saw the original Apollo missions control room, which is now preserved as it was for visitors to go and see. Seems to have sent Puppy Fractic into a bit of a trance. Oh, you are awake. Okay. So, how can we communicate using a Commodore 64? with the space station? Well, the answer is amateur radio plus a modem. Here on the desk, I've got a couple of example modems. Now, this one is called the Master Modem for the Commodore 64. And this is actually one for the VIC-20, the VIC modem. Let's actually open this one up and take a look. And all you would do is plug this into the user port at the back of the computer, set it to data, and plug in your phone line for these connections here. Do that again. And with that all set up, you plug this into your landline, something I don't have anymore, and away you go. But actually, it's kind of lucky that I don't have a landline because we're not going to be using wires. Now, when computers talk to other computers, it's kind of like, as you probably know, two fax machines speaking to each other through the landline. So I want you to think about our project, talking to the space station, as essentially like two fax machines communicating through cell phones. Cell phones essentially just use radio waves. And just like our little project, they encode your voice, and we're going to be encoding some text, into binary data. They send it through the radio waves. And if you could intercept it from your cell phone, it would sound just like a fax. Now, you could even build your own modem using some of the schematics available on the internet. And to produce the PCB, we recommend PCB Way! Sorry, Way! Because as we all know, PCB stands for Planet Communication Boards, doesn't it? Oh. Now, I've always been fascinated by amateur radio. Before I had my first ever Apple IIe, which you can see over there, first ever computer my dad ever brought home.
They got me a computer.
We had a CB radio. Pick up your mic and you'd be on the main channel, which I think was 14, and you'd say like 1414 for a copy, copy, copy. Now, I was 8 years old. I even met a girl through CB radio. Silver Stallion, if you're out there, little badger here, drop me a... I don't know how you'd communicate. Anyway, things kind of moved on after that and we got our computer.
We got me a computer.
And indeed, a lot of the community moved on to bulletin boards, chat rooms on those. That continued to evolve into what we now know as things like Slack and Discord, which explains why they still use terminology like channels. And of course, I've still got my own channel here. Only now my handle is Perifractic, not Little Badger. So that's the context. And the other part of what inspired this idea is back in September, the ISS received this device so that astronauts could talk to students and sometimes enthusiasts as well as part of the ARIS program. This radio features an over-the-air modem, or TNC, which encodes short bursts of data to be sent via the ISS's antenna, which you can see being installed here. But crucially, it can also receive data packets sent from Earth, where it will retransmit them back down to Earth. Now, one benefit of this, and a reason why they did it, is it allows two places that are otherwise out of radio reach with each other to be patched into each other via the ISS. But cooler still, even those messages will be visible to the astronauts on the screen of their device. So yeah, it is possible that they're not only going to retransmit it, but they might actually see that we've sent something from 1982. So let's see if our trusty old C64 can do the sending. First, we'll need our amateur radio tuned to 145 MHz VHF. That's the channel reserved for space communications. And an antenna in the garden. And on the C64, we're actually going to use this Tiny 2 modem from 1987, powered by its oh-so-powerful Z80 processor. That's the same one found in the ZX Spectrum computers. And we're just going to connect this to the C64 using RS-232. Now, finally, we need to be able to type a message on the C64 keyboard to the ISS. For that, we should be able to use any terminal program. And fortunately, there are exactly 500 million of those, albeit zero of which were ever designed to talk to space. And for that, we've chosen Noverterm version 9.6c. And because we're connected through the user port of the Commodore 64, just go find that option, select the user port, and let's see if turning on our modem works. Houston?
We have a problem.
Yeah, the TNC doesn't want to talk with our Commodore 64. I'm just going through the pre-flight checklist here with Puppy Fractic. Could you avert your gaze to the checklist, please? We've set everything up okay. It's running at 1200 BPS and 8 data bits, no parity bit, and 1 stop bit, of course, commonly known as 8N1, right? Right. So let's connect the Commodore 64 directly to a PC. That way we can troubleshoot whether the modem or the Commodore is at fault. And with the terminal loaded on the PC as well, whatever we type on the Commodore 64 keyboard appears on the PC screen. And vice versa, whatever we type on the PC's keyboard will appear on the Commodore's screen. So it's clear that the connection from the Commodore 64 user port is working correctly. So why isn't the modem? Wait a minute, when we actually read the instructions properly, it's even underlined, it says the wires must be connected as shown in the table. And actually the cable we're using has extra wires for flow control, which is sending signals that are basically messing up the connection. So long story short, here's the cable cut in half and those flow control wires disconnected and the rest of it wired back together. We'll tidy that up later, but for now, I just want to get on, try and contact space. Welcome. Yes, and there we go. We can see the modem is now talking to the Commodore 64, copyright 1985 to 1994. Now, one thing we want to configure is the Commodore 64 function keys to send predefined messages. The reason for this is we're going to probably have to try several times, if it will even work at all, to reach the ISS. So we don't want to have to keep typing the same thing. So let's set that up now. Okay, so the Commodore 64 is connected to the modem. The modem is connected to the VHF radio, and the radio is connected to the antenna outside, and that will hopefully connect to the ISS antenna. The next thing we need to do is know when the ISS will be overhead and within range. And luckily, there are some very cool websites that will actually tell you when the ISS will be overhead for you. Pretty exciting, right? Now all we can do is track the ISS and wait for it to come overhead. And I'm just gonna leave you with the sound and sight of the machines doing all the work. Fingers crossed. Well, the station is traveling out of range and we're running out of time. Let's wait for about 90 minutes for the next pass of the ISS, and we'll try again. Well, I think we'll just give it one more try, and then we're going to have to call it a day. There it is. That's it. CQ, NA1SS is the call sign for the space station. One space station sent from a Commodore 64! Exclamation point. So that means that the ISS received our transmission sent from a 1982 computer, saw it on the screen, on the display, where the astronauts could have seen it too, and they rebroadcast it to Earth. Guys, we essentially put Commodore 64 in space. Ow. And knowing how much I've always wanted to be in space myself, it was time to see if they'd retransmit one more message for us.
Houston, what's a perifractic?
Isn't that incredible? That is truly out of this world. And it is quite fitting that the next expedition to the ISS is going to be Expedition 64. Can't write this stuff, even though she writes most of it for me. Speaking of which, if you have any wacky ideas of things we can do with the Commodore 64 or any other of these computers, let me know in the comments below. I try to respond and interact with every comment that is left. Because of course, any of these computers could have done that, as long as they have the ability to connect a modem through that RS-232 port, even a ZX Spectrum or an Apple IIe. Well, other than that, all that remains for me is to say thank you so much for watching. Subscribe and support below. It's time for Puppyfractic's walk. I should not have said that out loud. I better go, or as we say in the business, 10-10 till we meet again.
Is that okay with you?
I don't know if you can hear that, but the coyotes are serenading the ISS. And Puppy Fractic II is serenading the coyotes.
Is that your kin, Kinfolk?